with the speaker, Mr. Balan Nambiar. GD Center of Art was established by artist Jatin Das and is envisioned as a unique art center that aims to preserve and exhibit its large collection of folk, tribal, traditional and contemporary art all under one roof. The building has been designed by architect B.V. Doshi and is currently under construction in Bhubaneswar, Odisha. GDC organizers, this artist lecture series where invited artists, craftspersons or scholars share their work and insight through an illustrated talk. Since 2001, 248 such illustrated lectures have taken place on the second Saturday of every month. Currently, our sessions are being held online. Balan Nambiar. Balan Nambiar is a painter, sculptor, enamelist, and a photographer. He's also a research scholar on ritual arts of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. He has held 36 solo exhibitions of his creative works in India and Europe since 1966 and published 23 research papers so far. He's a recipient of state and national awards for his creative work sculpture of Lalit Kala Academy, senior fellowship of from the Ministry of Culture, and the Nehru Fellowship from the Jawaharlal Nehru Foundation for his academic research. He was a member of the Central Advisory Board on Culture for the Ministry of Culture and the Apex Committee of the National Gallery of Modern Art. He was also the acting chairman of Lalit Kala Academy, Delhi, amongst many other positions that he's held. A retrospective exhibition comprising drawings, paintings, sculptures in different medium, jewelry, enamel paintings and photographs of his past 60 years was held at the NGMA, National Gallery of Modern Art, Bangalore in 2018. Over to the Chairman Jatin Das.
I welcome you all to join this 249 Meet the Artist program of the JD Center of Art that we have established in Bhubaneswar in Odisha. And it was every month on the second Saturday in Bhubaneswar. Since the epidemic has been online, which is in a way been better because it has reached out to innumerable people all over the country. So Balan is a very dear friend whom I respect immensely, and we are very dear friends. And I've stayed with him, he has stayed with me. And we were together in Bhubaneswar during a heavy cyclone. You know, we were caught inside and we did many drawings together. Balan is a unique sculptor in the country who has a synthesis between art and science. But he is one of the very few who started from his roots in Kerala as a farmer. And not only that, I personally feel anybody who has started from the rural India, he has the enrichment of innumerable things. The music, dance, theater, painting, architecture, agriculture, and so on. So to Balan, my dear friend.
Balanji.
Thanks to Jatin, thanks to Siddhartha and IAC officials for giving me this opportunity. And 8 years ago, 2013, I was in Bhubaneswar in the month of October on a second Saturday. And yeah, exactly 8 years ago. And there was a cyclone the previous night, and all the roads were blocked and electricity was shut. So there was no presentation of mine as scheduled. There were only limited number of people who were able to reach there by walk. But we started, Jatin, as usual, he said, let us not waste our time. Let us sketch. And we did this, several sketches, and Jatin did my portrait, and you know, there are so many things. Anyway, I'm actually grateful to JDCA for giving me this opportunity to repeat what I missed in that day. Well, I have been doing this particular presentation mainly to the people who are in the technical field, and also in Delhi at the Rasa Foundation and many architecture institutions at the National Gallery of Modern Art, Bangalore, and NIAS, National Institute of Advanced Studies. See, as Jadin mentioned briefly, I come from a rural area in Kerala, in the northern Kerala, from a family of farmers. Till my 18th year, I was plowing the field. And I know every stage of a paddy cultivation and many other vegetables. And I am proud of what I have been brought up in that particular agricultural family. And what was fascinating for me at that particular time was ritual performances existing in the village. We look forward to that kind of ritual performances. And I used to sit next to the man who is doing the makeup of body decoration and facial makeup of the ritual performance. And as a child of 5 years or 6 years, I used to go to school and draw the same makeup in the slate. So I still remember, and my drawings were good, and I got the best encouragement from my teacher. Probably that is the starting point of my artistic talent. And also, very near to my village, my house, there are potter community, and I used to get clay from them, and I used to meddle with clay and did many figures, tortoise, elephant, fish, and bartered these to my friends to get a gooseberry or mango or whatever it is. But then I was in high school. My favorite subject was mathematics and drawing. I was really fascinated by drawing, mathematics, interest in mathematics, and that has really led to the technical studies and job, then led to the fine arts college, etc. This preparation of golden ratio, Fibonacci sequences, fractals in mathematics, nature, and the arts is prepared from a unique experience in 1978. I was in Germany. I was invited by the German government, and I got an opportunity to do a large sculpture with a new medium called glass fiber reinforced cement. Before showing these slides, I would like to acknowledge my indebtedness and grateful thanks to three individuals who helped me to realize this presentation. One is my wife, who is a physicist and nuclear physicist, in fact, but she is also a mathematician and a teacher. She is fond of mathematics as well as art, being a daughter of an artist, an analyst, and she helped me in various stages of this presentation. It is Professor Vinod Gaur who really introduced me to Fibonacci numbers. He is the one who explained to me what is a Fibonacci numbers, and he told me the history. But eventually I was able to learn this from books and history, and I learned and made a lot of studies. Third is my collaborator, Priya Shyam, who helped me in this preparation of a presentation. Thanks to all of these people. At various stage, various people helped me in various subject, not only in the ritual dances, but also in my search for mathematics, architecture, technical drawings, and subject like that. And now, because there is a time constraint, so let me go to the slide number. The first five slides are to introduce myself, what the subject I have been doing, which will help the people who are watching this to know who and what I am. One, please start. Yeah, this is the subject, and of course today, next. See, these are the subject of my research. On the left is a theme, all this except one, two. One is a thera, and the last one on the right side bottom is related to snake motif worship in Nagamandala performances. These are themes. Themes are ritual performances. People go to the, invoke the blessing of divinity, get possessed by the spirit of the divinity, and get into a trance-like state and dance to the tune of vigorous drumming. It's a total art form. The Deyam performer is a musician, dancer, painter, sculptor, choreographer, and actor, and also has some special power to withstand the strenuous dance performance, walk through the fire, hit himself with a sharp sword, and bless the devotees who seek their blessings. Next, please. So these are bronze sculptures which I did from student days till much later, and the last two sculptures were cast in Bonvicini foundry in Verona in Italy. It's a small sculpture, but the perfection of casting is superb. Bonvicini foundry is where most of our senior bronze sculptors in Europe cast their bronze sculptures. Next. These are the sculptures, and the first three sculptures were done in 5 of the sculptures were done in 1975. I had an exhibition of garden sculptures in front of Wat Ashoka in Bangalore, and the tallest sculpture was 18 feet high, and there were 24 sculptures in the exhibition, and smallest sculpture was taller than my height. I am 6 feet tall. Next. These are drawings and paintings done in various stages, and it just to show what my creative work is. Next. These are enamel painting. These are jewelry enamel, unlike the commercial enamel. These are meant for jewelry, gold, silver, or copper. And I learned this technique from my father-in-law, who was considered to be in the greatest enamel artist of Italy in the 20th century. And this, I used silver, base is copper. So those two sculptures on the top are fairly large, about half a meter in height. Next. This is the sculpture I was actually briefly mentioning earlier, made in glass fiber reinforced cement in Germany in 1978. And I made this sculpture. I made six sculptures at the Research and Development Center of Lehman, Fortan Cement Factory. And when I made this sculpture, I was using just a tape, but I didn't actually think about the proportion in a measured architectural drawing. When I finished this sculpture, the senior technical engineer or expert in the research center came with a tape and measured and told me this is a golden, this followed the golden ratio principle. I didn't think about that. I knew about golden ratio, but I didn't make any study at that point. He said the width to height is 1.618, and that is the proportion he found in this particular sculpture. And then I was staying at, I was visiting an American couple, students of South Asia Institute in Heidelberg. I did this in Heidelberg, in Germany, near Heidelberg. Leimen is near Heidelberg. And just by coincidence, there was a BBC program on seashells. There was a specific description about a particular kind of shell with which has a golden ratio. It was a coincidence. It really fascinated for me. And I knew about the conch, and I knew about the Varampuri Shlanka, that means conch with clockwise spiral, which is used in Shaktiya temples during puja and in all the Shaktiya temples of Kerala had this special conch. That was the source of inspiration. But relating to golden ratio happened much later from this Germany experience. Next. This is the golden ratio, what I have been actually telling you. See, golden ratio is a rectangle. If width is actually 1 meter, if the height is 1 meter, the width is 1261803. It is an irrational number. There is never ending actually the decimal points. But for convenience, by artists and architects and people who are interested in golden ratio, used the 3 decimal point. So it is actually 1 meter, 1 to 1.618. That is the ratio. This is applied. This is the most comfortable measurement or proportion of any object we can actually think of, painting or craft objects or architecture or any other, even a screen in theater, it can be actually used. Even the movement of people or the composition which is on the theater or object which you make or the figures which you incorporate in the painting, all this can actually be controlled within this proportion of 1 meter by 1.1 to 1.618 ratio, which is a golden ratio. Next. This can be actually done in various way. Phidias, Greek architect, sculptor, and painter who lived in the 5th century, is actually one of the earliest person whom proportion is attributed to, and he is actually known, referred as a Greek letter phi. So the 1 to here, AB and BF is actually the golden ratio, but the square, what you see here, ABCD, is divided off and taken E to D as a center, keeping E as a center and making an arch from D and ending to F. That is actually the point, and you make a rectangle. That rectangle is a golden ratio. Next. This can be actually used or explained in with mathematical principle. That is, phi is actually 1 plus root of 5 divided by 2. Same thing can be actually said, 1 by phi is 2 divided by 1 plus root of 5. That is equivalent to 2 divided by 1 plus root of 5, and et cetera, what you see here. Next. This can be actually again say, you know, phi, 1 by phi is 0.61834, etc. That number, as I said earlier, is an irrational number. It goes from any number without point because of it is a rational number. Next. The same thing which you can think, you can construct golden ratio, that if you make a circle, take the diameter or the radius, the from here 0 to B is the radius, and if you double that, you see B to A is AF, as you hear, see F is to is equivalent to FB, is equivalent to BC, equivalent to half of the AB. AO is the root of 5 divided by 2. And AC is equivalent to EE, AE is equivalent to minus 1 plus root of 5 divided by 2, which is actually result is a 0.6183. So the AB to AE is equal to AE to AEB, which is equal to phi. Next. This is one beautiful way of explaining how this rectangle, you divide and you reduce to a square and golden ratio, and you come to a spiral. You can construct a spiral. The green line represents the logarithmic spiral, and the blue line is the approximation drawn as arches in quarter of circles. I used this measurement in various sculptures I made later in stainless steel. Next. See, there are two type of prominent spirals. One is Archimedean spiral. If you take a rope with say a diameter or a diameter of say 5 inches or 5 centimeter, for practical purpose, we'll say 5 centimeter, and make a round, the diameter of the rope is actually constant. So the spiral is created with the distance of OA, AB, BC, CD, and the diameter length or the thickness is the same, but it is a spiral. But the logarithmic spiral, it actually increases the 0 to A to B, and B to C. The proportion is constant. O to A is to E, A to B is the same AB to ABC. And this actually is the most important thing. You know, in my yoga practice, my teacher once told me, if you concentrate on this kind of visual spiral and keeping your navel as a center and go on increasing, you can actually dream about the universe. You can actually, the circle, the spiral may reach first navel to groin to chest, then a navel to knee and neck, and then navel to the feet and head, and then a bed, the distance of the bed, then the distance of the room, then distance of the house, then distance of the area where you are living, and it can expand. That expansion is actually incredible. We can even encompass the universe. Next. See, this is one of the finest example of a logarithmic spiral. This is a cross section of a shell. This shell, you can see the black, red, and blue. That is actually the proportion from center to next. See, the black is to red is the same red to blue, and it can actually expand. It depend upon the shape, it will increase. When the shell grows, it grows in the same proportion and expand to the outer line of the spiral. Next. Yeah, here this is an example. For example, a falcon, the bird falcon, see a prey, or for example, maybe a rabbit or a frog in the land. It falcon may be even half a kilometer above the land, but it, by a particular angle of the wings, it, without flapping the wings, it actually go in the same pattern of the logarithmic spiral and reach to the prey. In this spiral, this angle where you made the, you can actually see the angle, and it shows up to it, that angle of the shift is constant. Next. See, galaxy has the same type of the proportion of the logarithmic spiral. Next. There is another way of calculating this. This is the golden rectangle and golden triangle. The golden ratio, a rectangle with the golden ratio, if you keep it in a vertical, like the 1 meter, say for example, one, and the pi on the left side, and the top point, if you join together, you create a triangle. That triangle is actually golden triangle. But if you keep the rectangle in a horizontal position and use the same two sides and bring down to create a triangle with 108 degrees on the top and 36 on the left and 36 degrees on the right, you create a triangle, and that is a golden triangle. That is a golden rectangle. And where you can see the distance of one, the, for example, so BA and AC is the same as the size or side of the rectangle. And the phi is a constant. Next. The most fascinating shape for me is a pentagon. Not right, you know, I mean, circle is important, and a rectangle or triangle or equilateral triangle or any other triangle, but pentagon is the mysterious form. Pentagon, you can make hundreds and thousands of different shapes. It can go up to infinity. If you look at the left diagram, you can see from the apex of a pentagon, if you join together, you are getting an golden triangle. 36 degrees on the top and 72 degrees on both sides of the bottom. The same thing, if you repeat 3 or 5 times on the other side, you get actually different diagram, different golden triangle. Pentagon can be divided in 5 golden triangles of each type, and an inner pentagon which can be divided again infinitely. Then you can see the pentagon in the middle. That pentagon is really, you can increase or decrease and create innumerable pentagon forms in this kind of drawings. Next. Same pentagon, golden triangle can be used in such a way we can make the equilateral triangle, equiangular triangle. The first one is actually there. As you make the diagram, you get the same proportion of the golden triangle, and the same, it is again repeated in such a way, and keeping a circle based on this, you can make various a form of equiangular spiral. Next. Penrose is a gold, Roger Penrose is 90 years old now. He was born in 1931. He has invented some forms which has influenced tile making and tile laying on the floors equal distances. He is the English mathematician, and it has influence the product of various items and following this particular measurement. He used this golden ratio and pentagon and all this what I have explained early. Next. Now, see, in Indian context, there are so many references. See, Bahudayana Sutra of 8th to 7th BC, the earliest recorded statement of the Pythagorean theorem is actually made in India before Pythagoras was born in 6th century. And this was known to India through Sulba Sutra, which has used, which was actually a text for the altars or Vedic rituals. that was made in between 8th and 6th century BC. And Pythagoras' triplet, which is known 3, 4, 5, that as a group, or 5, 12, 13 as another group, 7, 12, 24 and 25, that's another group. If using these as a side, you can make a rectangle. Even as a child, high school student, I used 3, 4, 5. If you use 3 inches, 4 inches height, and the angle which you make in that line, that will be 5. If it is perfect, that right side corner is a right angle. So one need not use any measurement or compass to divide or divide this angle, but with just a thread we can make a right triplet and make a right angle diagram. And this is used in Sulba Sutra. Sulba Sutra is mainly for the altars of Vedic rituals. Agni Chayana or Adhiratra rituals are based on Sulba Sutra. Then Pythagoras' 6th century BC had a strong influence in science, politics, and art. Perfection, mathematics, and proportions. The Pythagorean choose the pentagram as their symbol. Aryabhatta, who actually lived in Pataliputra, that is Patna, in the 5th, 6th century. And he, at the age of 23, made Aryabhattiyam, a text of mathematic principles. It is still valid, and it's one of the finest and very authoritative mathematic text ever produced in India. Aryabhatta is actually responsible or author of Aryabhattiyam. Euclid of Alexandria knew about this divine proportion. He used the word divine proportion. Golden ratio also is called divine ratio, because many painters used golden ratio. There, when if it is not exact measurement of 1 to 1.618, at least they will say 2 to 3 as very approximate. That proportion is used. But here, Euclid is the first person who lived in the 5th century BC who made divine proportion, who used the word divine proportion to golden ratio. Al-Khwarizmi, or Persian, that is 9th century, he also made this logarithm and found this proportion accurately. Abu Kami Salja, there is another Egyptian who made this pentagram and decagram, and there is also there is Fibonacci numbers. Next. Here, a Platonic solid have a congruent regular or polygonal face, and the same number of faces meet at each vertex. That means the corner of all these forms may have a similarity to the supporting ideas or this. For example, tetrahedron, hexahedron, octahedron, dodecahedron, and icosahedron. And if you join golden rectangle with the vertex at the center of faces, golden rectangle with the vertex at the vertex, of the faces. All these are actually, you create rectangles inside these forms. All of them are maintain golden ratio. Next. Now coming to the Fibonacci numbers or Fibonacci sequences. Fibonacci was a son of an accountant who lived in Italy, and he was helping his father and preparing the account, and he was fascinated by this number, how it is actually coming. Even in India or in other countries, people who are involved in the stock exchange are familiar with the Fibonacci numbers. Fibonacci numbers are very known, and it is actually immediately we can say 1, 2, 1, 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, and 1, 2, 2 plus, you know, you can actually see it is written 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, etc. It will go. And early Sanskrit poets used the formation of a certain numbers as a basis for the meter of some poems. These numbers turned out to be the Fibonacci sequences. For very easy to remember, Mahabharata is written, all the text, all the almost all at least, are written in Anushtup Vritta or meter. Anushtup has an 8 number. Say, Sambhavami Yuge Yuge is one line of Gita. You can see it is 8 letters. All the stanzas has 8 letters. 8 is actually Fibonacci number. But there are many other vritta or the meters where the pause is actually follow the Fibonacci numbers. Acharya Hemachandra, studying the rhythm around 1150 to 1150, presented an earlier version of Fibonacci sequences. So it was known to Indian maths, but it is Fibonacci who exposed the methodology of or justifying math theory into the Western world. Next. Yeah, here it is actually a little more clear. You know, if you take this on the left side measurement numbers, 1 by 1 is actually 1, 2 by 1 is actually 2. 3 by 2 is 1.5, then 5 by 3 is 1.666, and 8 by 5 is 1.6000, and 13 by 8 is 1.62500, and like that, if you go after 144 divided by 89, you get 1.6179, etc. And 233 divided by 144, you get 618056. It is an irrational number, as I said earlier. However, if you take these 3 decimal points as a part of this, from 233 onwards, all the numbers of Fibonacci numbers get the result divided by the previous sum of 2 numbers, result is a Fibonacci golden ratio, that is 1 to 1.618. This is constant from 233 onwards. And the same thing, Johannes Kepler, Johannes Kepler, German, found a graphical representation of this. The first points are actually so far away from the central line, but eventually it comes to central line and it repeats central line constantly. Next. The Fibonacci number is repeated in this diagram of an equiangular spiral. That is 1 plus 1 is 2. That square is a 2, and next square is a 3, and next is a 5, and next is a 8. And this is what I used in one of my sculptures, which you will see later. Next. In nature, this Fibonacci number play a very important role. You can identify, say, a starfish has a 5 point. Even if you cut an apple across the way, you get 5 seeds in the middle. Then flowers, and some flowers have 3 petals, and some are 8, some are 13, another 21, 34, 55, 89, it goes on. But almost all are based on all petals of the flowers follow the pattern of a golden ratio, or pattern of Fibonacci numbers. Next. See, this is a sunflower seed. There are actually sunflower with 89 and 55 spirals at the edge. Both are Fibonacci numbers. On the clockwise direction, there are 89 spirals. On the anti-clockwise, counterclockwise direction, there are 55 spirals. This is the nature. Nature has given this spiral. Next. In the Giza pyramid, they found on the center, as you can see on the right side diagram, it actually follow the golden ratio and that angle. So Pythagoras lived in the 6th century BC, Euclid and Alexander in 3rd century BC, Aryabhatta in the 4th, 5th century AD, and Al-Khwarizmi, and like that you can see 825 AD, and Fibonacci 1202, and Pacioli, which is another Italian mathematician, painter, is again in the 15th century AD. Next. I have studied many forms of Indian sculptures, but I couldn't accurately find any of this golden ratio in the forms, Indian forms. But Fibonacci numbers were repeated in nature, and there are instances. Next. This is the approximate previous one, please. Okay, anyway, here, these are Greek monuments. The Parthenium with on the right side is following the golden ratio of how it is actually constructed. And this is created by Phidias, who was a mathematician, architect, painter, and sculptor. Next. This is the Epidaurus Theater in Greece, 400 BC, and Theatron, the place of the spectators, are divided in 34 and 21 rows, which is actually Fibonacci numbers. The angle in which the auditorium is constructed in relation to the stage is on a 0.618, which is a golden ratio. Most of this theater has exceptional acoustic. Most of the ancient theaters maintain this ratio. Next. This is Notre Dame, Paris, and it was built in the 12th century. This is the time Giotto, the painter, started using depicting three-dimensional in murals. But here again, these are squares, rectangles, and other things to follow golden ratio and Fibonacci sequences numbers. Next. This is Piero della Francesca, is a 15th century artist, late Renaissance artist. He followed the principle of golden ratio. So he purposely marked this arch, which you see on top, as a second portion. The below that is a square. So this is the rectangle, and Renaissance is a rebirth of classical Greek and Roman art culture and ideas among the is the study of mathematics and the arts. Piero della Francesca exemplified this new shift in Italian Renaissance thinking. According to Vasari, the great scholar and biographer of most of artists of that century, he said actually Piero della Francesca was one of the greatest musicians. See, artists, painters were actually, it is not exclusive, they do only painting. They were mathematicians, they were sculptors, they were architects, or vice versa, in the opposite there. Architects were painters, sculptors, and poets like Leonardo da Vinci, for example. Next. See, this is the Sacrata Vecchia in San Lorenzo in Florence. This elevation follows the golden ratio. Same way, next. This is Brunelleschi, who lived in the 16th century, and he made here, not only this elevation, next please, even the plan of the same building follow the golden ratio. Next. This Piccioli, Luca Piccioli, collaborator of Leonardo da Vinci, and this is here, this painting is done by Jacopo di Barberi, but he's actually showing Luca Piccioli doing the painting, where showing geometrical form based on some diagrams from the book. Next. This is a drawing by Leonardo da Vinci. He used the spiral in the head decoration or the hair decoration, which is actually shown. He used these various forms, even his horse also followed the golden ratio's proportion while making this. Next. Mona Lisa's face has a proportion of a golden ratio, and here an artist is trying to explain how it is actually divided. Next. This is a famous Vitruvian man, originally designed in the 15th century by Vitruvius, 81 BC and 15 AD, who lived in the Vitruvius. And this diagram is attributed to Vitruvius, who first originated, but then later encoded by Leonardo da Vinci. And this drawing is Leonardo da Vinci's drawing, but he lived in the late Renaissance period. Next. This is a Greek proportion. Usually in human form, the proportion, there are AB, you can see AB, and proportion, capital A and small letter A is the golden ratio proportion. And C and C, you can see capital C and smaller C, and capital B and this smaller B. All these proportions, if you look at it, you can see golden ratio as the most important proportion. Next, even the jar also. Here, this is a Chola bronze sculpture diagram, and this is a Uttama Navatala, there is Dasatala, then Amutta, there is Uttama, that means there is a Madhyama and Adama proportion. And I studied many drawings of Chola bronzes. This is Chola, Chera, Chalukya, and Pallava. These are four styles of human. I have not come across a golden ratio anywhere. However, there is a specific measurement. There is a very good recorded measurement of a proportion of male and female, and also Vaishnavite figure and Shaivite figure, and also Uttama figures, Adama figures, and Madhyama figures. And there are these different style also. The curve on the bottom of your feet is different from one style to the other. I just want to say Indian characters, Indian traditional sculptures did not follow the Western concept of golden ratio proportion. But we have our own proportion of figures. But unfortunately, because of English education and because of not getting the real exposure, these are not known to many people. It is still confined to artisan community of Indian many sections, many areas. There are fantastic stone carvers in Tamil Nadu and in Orissa and Rajasthan. Next. This only to come say it is not really golden ratio. Tomb of Selim Kisti, Pratapa Sekri, and it was made in 1581. This shows golden ratio. Next. Even Taj Mahal, if you geometrically analyze its proportion, and you can actually see the golden ratio as well as golden triangle in this diagram. It is the 16th century. The architect is Ustad Isal Shirazi. Next. See, modern painters used the spiral in their own way. Van Gogh's Starry Night and Gustav Klimt used this spiral in their painting. There are many other examples, but I'm just showing you how the painters used their spiral on the golden ratio in their creative work. Next. See, Kandinsky's painting, if you analyze, you can see the spiral on the center. There are two spirals, and if you analyze that, it's actually in the golden ratio. Same way in clay also, Paul Klee's painting, you have some areas. There are many other painters, at least about 20 painters I have identified, but these are actually known. I mean, just for example, I'm presenting to you. Next. See, Gino Severini, who lived in, born in 1883 and died in 1966, he used the golden ratio as this rectangle, but he tried to analyze the color and connection to music. But we have this tradition of Ragamalika painting in any case. The painting which he made, Severini, he also used golden ratio. If you look at this, that window is, border of the window is actually the starting point of a square and rectangle which combined together golden ratio. Incidentally, Severini is a collaborator of my father-in-law. They together made some enamels, and one of a big enamel as big as about 1 meter by 1.25 meters is still inherited by my wife. So we are sentimentally connected to the Severini. Next. See, this Mondrian's painting on the back, but Gerrit Rietveld's red and blue chair, which is a famous design. All the designers all over the world is some one time or other have seen or studied this proportion and the way it is made. And it is in front of a painting by Mondrian. Next. Another painting by Mondrian. Again, you can see the square and its proportion and golden ratio is repeated. Next. Le Corbusier. Le Corbusier, he used the modular theory based on the human proportion. Again, it is actually the modular proportion, and he has used it in many of his buildings. You can see just by one glance, you can see. Next, please. One glance, you can see how the proportion of golden ratio is used in the building, Mill Owners Association building in Ahmedabad on the left, and a UNO building in New York, built in 1952, Oscar Niemeyer and Le Corbusier to the. Next, please. See, in 2006, an engineering plant called California, they designed this building. A layout is based on the equiangular spiral. You can see on the left diagram, as well as on the courtyard in front of the Polytechnic building in California, 2006. It is not forgotten. Even modern contemporary architect even use Kalatrava, for example. I will come to you that. Next. Yeah, here is Kalatrava. He uses that and he says, the principle I follow are based on repetition. This reminds you of the nature, because nature often works in patterns. Santiago Kalatrava, born in 1951, that is, he is 70 years now. And he has made this a huge building. Next. Go back one slide back, please. He made this design 2006 and constructed much later. Next. This is a design, human proportion, and he used the human proportion and made the leg for a table, made in 1998. Next, by Kalatrava. Next. Say, Thomas Alenso 1974 made a shelf following the golden ratio principle. Next. Next, please. Hope I'm not clear. The proportion of the violin, if you really study each segment, you can see that a small rectangle or mark and bigger one, they follow the golden ratio. With the two, total is actually, and then this small portion. And even Beethoven's Fifth Symphony music composition, you can see the Fibonacci sequences repeated. There is a pause. That pause on the music follows the pattern of Fibonacci numbers. Next. See, Eisenstein's most famous silent film, Battleship Potemkin, used the principle of a golden ratio in various sequences of his recording or his film. Next. Now coming to the factors. Factors is actually a repetition. When it is repeated, it still maintains the original form every stage. Here it is a triangle on the left, and two triangles, one over the other in the opposite direction. And the same way, if you go on repeat, you get the patterns at the end, but it maintains the original equilateral triangle, which is on the left side. And even the leaf forms of a certain trees follow the pattern of this fractals in their growth. Next, leaves. Next. See, broccoli, it is a broccoli or onion. If you peel off one by one, you still maintain the same proportion or same form. In broccoli particularly, it also go to the spiral as well as the repetition of fractals. Next. In Bhuvaneswaram, Rajarani temple, you can see these. The pattern, same, if you take one small tower, but they are following the same pattern of all over design. Incidentally, the person who is watching that, one is, the girl is my student, and the other one is late Dinanath Pati. Next. I designed this for as a logo for Nias, following the Sulba Sutra principle of Sulba Sutra of 6th and 8th and 6th century BC. And this is altar used for Agni Chayana and Adhiratram ritual. And these rituals were conducted in Kerala, and I witnessed it, the ritual in 1976. It was a 12 days ritual. I was there for 4 days, and I was so fascinated by these rituals. Here I want to mention our ancestors in different culture, different areas. They have invested artistic treasure and accumulated over generations. And a contemporary artist like me are playing with the interest of those investment made by our ancient scholars and rishis and mathematicians, etc. So my attempt is like a homage paying to these ancient mathematicians and thinkers and scholars. Next. This is Sri Chakra. The Sri Chakra is actually, you know, there are five the triangles on the inverted way downward, and apex is downward, and four diagrams are on upward. There are nine triangles in this. So if you take the largest triangle, which is the base, you can actually find, if you divide half and see the triangle, you can see almost close to 5 and 1 to 1.618 ratio. I have used a Sri Chakra. Normally, Sri Chakras are drawn on a gold, silver, or copper plate or brass plates. And there are also diagrams on a stone. And there are some three-dimensional solid form called Shichakra in Meru form, but I used this principle. Next, please. This is my sculpture, and based on the Shichakra's principle, and the height is 33.5 centimeter, and diameter is 1 meter. And here, what I did, what is different from all other previous Shichakra is, I used a computer-generated drawing and kept a 15 millimeter gap between one layer to the second layer. I did several versions, but anyway, Shichakra is one of the most fascinating form all through our Indian culture. And this is the equiangular spiral in 3D. Earlier I was mentioning how I used, and this is the triangle that base is 1 meter high, 1 meter diameter, but height is 33 centimeter. And there are 12 triangles. And next, please. Yeah, this is the diagram, this computer generated drawing I prepared, and we prepared, I should say, because an architect was helping me. And here, biggest diagram, rectangles, triangle is the here. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that way. There are 12 quarter angle, circle is used in making this equiangular 3D spiral. Next. This is the Valambiri Shankha conch in stainless steel. Height is 1 centimeter less than 2 meter. And this follows the golden ratio. And the portion of the conch follows the golden ratio. The base is different. And earlier I mentioned how the Valambiri Shankha, the conch, has inspired me. And this is one of the landmark in my artistic career. I made in 2000, this sculpture. From 2000 onwards, I was doing only stainless steel sculptures. I stopped mild steel sculptures or iron sculptures in 1999, and 2000, I got a commission from Texas Instrument, and there is the beautiful story to tell, because it's interesting to people who are listening to this. Texas Instrument director of their R&D division once met me, and I said actually he would like to see my sculptures. So I took him to Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research in Bangalore and showed three of my sculptures which are in their collection. They are all very large sculptures. One is 18 feet high, another is a stone sculpture, 3.5 meter by 3.5 meter by 1.5 meter. And another is about 4 meters high. And after seeing that, he asked me if I could do a sculpture depicting DSP. DSP is a digital signal processing. That DSP has influenced, it contains almost every electronic items of a computer age. In your mobile phone has a DSP and many other items you can see. I didn't know that what is a DSP at that point when he mentioned about. So I asked him to explain and asked him to give me a literature or video of what it is. And he said he would like me to think about doing a sculpture for him, for the Texas Instrument. So he sent me a packet of videos and literature on DSP to me. Texas Instrument is the first foreign company who brought DSP to India in 1986. So they were celebrating their 25th anniversary or 50th anniversary or something like that. So they asked me the 25th anniversary. And then they asked me to do the, it is in connection with a conference for their celebration, then asked me to do this. I was start thinking, I thought this idea And anyway, I know about the conch and golden ratio and the Fibonacci sequences. And I stuck me the idea of principle of Om. Om is the root or Bija Mantra, and it contains three syllables, which combine, if properly pronounced, you get Om, Omkara. That has a, because it is a Bija Mantra, it has a mystical sound, and it has inspired me to design this, to depict the DGP, DSP. So I designed this and used a conch, because conch, if you keep it in your ear, you can hear the sound of sea waves. And in any case, I designed, keeping this in mind, to depict DSP using Om principle, and made this sculpture. This was published in Limca Book of Records in 2002 edition as a first high-tech sculpture in India. Next, please. Now it is in Indian Institute of Science. The trajectory of a planet, it is a 162 centimeter height and 1 meter width and 95 meters in depth, made in 2004. And overall measurement is influenced by golden ratio. Next. This is a cactus. It is a 1.25. I won't say it is a Fibonacci numbers, but it is inspired by Fibonacci numbers. And then, it is a favorite sculpture for me because it is an autobiographical symbol of my character or myself. Because the cactus is a plant which asserts its right to exist in an odd, uncongenial atmosphere in a hostile surrounding. As a practicing artist for last 61 years, I never actually bothered to, compromise with my principle to anybody, even when I did huge monumental sculptures. So cactus is one of many, a series of sculptures I made. This is one. Next. One is also a cactus, is entirely different, and but you can see the idea of a factor in this work. Next. Next. This is a 6.2 meters high, nearly more than 18 feet, 8.5 feet high. I made for Timken Skull factory in Bangalore. I made in 2004. Computer designed, computer generated design, and stainless steel, and is one of my very impact sculpture I made. Next. This is a close-up of the same sculpture in another view. Both the photo on the left side is made by me, and the other one is made by Namas Bhajani, a great photographer. Next. This is a sculpture I made in Delhi. It is in Delhi, in Sadiq Nagar, in the Indian Oil Corporation chairman's office. When I got this commission in 2010, originally their budget was very limited and I refused. I said, I can't do any sculpture of that. But I was very keen to do a monumental sculpture in Delhi. National Gallery of Modern Art has 5 of my sculptures, but no other sculpture in Delhi. Except Max Muller Bhavan has 2 of my sculptures, which are still my property, which is lying there. But no other organization or institution or Rathikala Karni bought my sculpture. And also, I don't blame anybody because I didn't exhibit also many times in Delhi. Only 3 exhibitions I participated, one man exhibition I had there. And anyway, this is on the 50th anniversary of Indian Oil Corporation. And they gave a very short budget, but I wanted a monumental sculpture, and I spent 31.5 lakhs of rupees for making this sculpture. It's a cost of production. I have a habit, any expenditure more than 10 rupees, I record in my computer. So I know how much money I spend on this sculpture. I didn't gain much money in this, not even 10%. But anyway, I have a satisfaction that I have a monumental sculpture in Delhi. Next. This is the center part of the same sculpture, the spiral. Next. This is a diagram of another sculpture I made for, this is the diagram I made for another sculpture. Next. This is the scale model of a sculpture. Photograph is a scale model. Originally it's a 2.6 meters high. I made for Ganjam Jewelers. It is a weaver bird nest. For me, weaver bird is actually one of the finest symbol of craftsmanship. With the beak and their feet, they build a nest, which is the safest nest in the whole world of bird nest. And that I made in 2015. Originally, it's a very large, 2.6 meters high. This is only 56 centimeter high. Next. This is a fountain of life I made. I used the spiral, you can see on the right side, and it's almost like a fountain. And it's made when I was commissioned to do a sculpture for BNP, bank note printing mill of Reserve Bank of India. Next. This is the sculpture, one view of that reach for the sky for BNPM Mysore, 7.2 meters high, that is nearly 23 feet high. Next. The beauty of this, there are 60 layers of a plate in between from beginning to end. And each plate is designed on the diagram on the right side. And if you take C and B and A, B, C, C, sum of A and B is the total weight of the sum A, elliptical form. So it is actually a combination of the weight factor as well as the shape. It's a, what is called a Fibonacci numbers in a way. Sum of these two is the total of the third one. And these layers of plate, I shifted 6 degrees from one plate to the other, on the 60 plates form 360 degrees, and that is the full circle. So the weight factor of this form is equally distributed and maintain equilibrium of the sculpture. And left side, you can see the diagram for laser cutting. Next. This is the full form of the sculpture. It is in an artificial island, and one can reach there, but nobody is allowed to go there. And also it is a restricted area because it's a currency paper making mill. So in order to reach there, one has to go through 4 checking points. Anyway, it is in Mysore. It is last. Next, please.
That's
okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you for, thank you, Jatin. Thank you, Siddhartha. Thank you for all the people who collaborated for making this possible. And thanks for the best wishes for JDCA. Thanks. Very much. I would like Jatin to say something for me.
Thank you very much. The Malayalis are very different than the rest of the people in the country. I tell you, the 100th Vida Artist Program in Bhubaneswar was run by RAD, Radhakrishnan.
Yes.
Radhakrishnan is the son of the great Nobel laureate scientist in Bangalore.
Yes.
C.V. Raman.
He is a friend of mine. I know Radhakrishnan.
Yeah. So Rad was a very close friend of mine. Very, very close. Yeah. One has to go to Bangalore, sometimes to stay with them.
Yeah.
And he gave a presentation called The Inseparable Relationship Between Art and Science.
Oh, very good, yeah.
And this was at the JD Center of Art, was not built. It was in the open air auditorium. And there were about 300 people there.
Yeah, okay.
And I misread, while you were talking about all this, recollecting and reminiscing him.
Oh, yeah.
And the inseparable relationship between art and science.
Yes, yes, I agree.
And you are fantastic. You know, hats off to you. And I don't think any artist in the country could fathom what you have done with science and art. And you're dear to me. But so I remember Radhakrishnan. One little thing I like to mention here, during the lockdown, in the Asiad village, I did about 1,000 sketches of plants and flowers.
Oh.
And I found about 90% of flowers have 5 petals. You know?
Yes, yeah, yeah.
So I'm talking about, I have no knowledge of, I don't believe in the separation of art and science. And Radhakrishnan had established that, and you have done it so beautifully. But I found this odd numbers. And why is it in everything there are 3 and 5 and 7 and 9? And the Navagraha, Panchamrita, Trinetra, and all that sort of thing, you know? So we'll continue the discussion later privately.
Okay.
I thank you very much. I hope a lot of our friends have listened to it. And I am grateful thanks to India International Center. And I hope friends of JDCA have taken deep interest in this. It was mind-blowing. Thank you, Balan. Thank you, very kind.
Balanji, I have a few questions to ask you.
Yeah.
One was that you were talking about the mathematics and especially the golden ratio.
Yeah.
And the Fibonacci in Indian context, and it's, you know, traditional. Yes. I was wondering, I mean, I don't know anything about it, but I wondered if there was any relation with the Jantar Mantar, and you know, because of being these kind of three-dimensional yantras,
yes,
you know, looking at astronomy, if there was any relation with that.
I have not studied on that. Probably it is an excellent subject. Most likely there will be some relations.
Oh,
because it is astronomy related things, so naturally. But whether it's a golden ratio or Fibonacci numbers. See, these are not known to unknown to India. It is already discussed in Sulba Sutra, and the scientist who lived in the past, even Srinivas Ramanujam actually mentioned about this in his theory. The present day mathematician knows. Here, late Radha Narasimha, who was former director of NIAS, National Institute of Advanced Studies, he was fascinated by this. We used to make a lot of discussions on this subject. He's a very close friend of mine. In fact, he published one of my research papers in the book edited by him. So mathematics and science and art. See, in European countries, in Greek and Italy especially, architects, mathematicians, philosopher, painter, they are all combined together. They coexisted. There are many musicians, many mathematicians who are architects and painters. Even Spanish, there is a painter who is an architect originally, but he is known more as a painter. But Leonardo da Vinci, for example, who can compare with him? There is all in all. Our greatest genius of human history, a creative genius, is Leonardo da Vinci. Like that, you know, you have to interrelate science, philosophy, and painting, sculpture, architecture. You know, in Italy especially, architect is not confined to building only. They will actually make many other designs. Even a door knob is designed by them, or cutleries are designed by them. Painters are actually same way. They can actually do all this, encompass all this knowledge.
Short of time.
Yeah, you should take the next question. Short of
No, please go ahead. There were a couple of other questions that I had till we can take some of the audience questions. One was that, have you, in one of the contemporary artists or modern artists, is there any work of Nasreen Mohammadi and, you know, people like that who did a lot of work with lines, geometry? Is there any play of that?
No, I don't know. I'm not familiar with that kind of lines. I haven't made any study.
And also the Islamic domes that we have?
Yes. Since Islamic art do not follow human figure, they always come or dependent on designs. Their geometrical patterns you can see in almost all over, not only flowers and decoration like Taj Mahal and Persian art or carpets and other. You can see geometrical patterns. See, Persia, Greece, Italy, and India have more mathematicians and original architect than any other nation together. Unfortunately, we don't know much about China because we don't have the information in English to know what is it. But I presume they have these kind of things. In a bronze casting of glass mirrors, they have a tradition 300 BC. I made a study and published a paper on that. So there are possibilities. But Islam architecture, Islamic decoration, Indian decoration, they used geometrical forms.
I mean, in case there are any other questions from the audience, please do put the questions in the Q&A chat box, and then I can field it and ask Balanji. Please let us know. And in the meantime, I'm going to ask you a couple of other questions, Balanji. This is about your research work. I mean, a lot of people don't know about research work, and you know, you've done so much research on the rituals of Kerala,
yes. And
you've done research on the Thayyam, but also on Bhuta. So yes. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, see, as I said, very beginning, I come from a village or the region of Kerala, which is on the southern, northern part of Kerala. And there are hundreds of Thayyam performances. There are hundreds of shrines for Thayyams. Do you know a unique thing of Northern Kerala among Thayyam? There are hundreds of shrines for Bali, the hero of King of Kishkindha. There is not even one Thayyam for Rama. And you know, there are so many Bhudas in Tulu Nadu. There are five wild animals, spirit of which are deified and worshipped in Thayyam. It is maybe the most ancient form of Thayyam because they are hunters, tribals, original people, and there. All these people, all this culture has nothing to do with the Aryan Hinduism. It is all based on tribal cult, based on non-Aryan cult, and no role for a Brahmin to conduct any puja in the conventional sense or in the Thayyam. In the temples there are Brahminical rituals. Even Thayyam performing, people also may go to Brahminical temples. But you know, Kerala is a unique. Both Vaishnavite and Shaivite, the gods are worshipped by the same people, same family, same caste group. If I go to the Kerala and see an old family, which I did many times during my field survey, instead of nowadays there is a caste distinction is minimal in Kerala compared to other part of India, and if I want to know the caste of another person, all I have to ask him, what is your family deity? If I know the name of a Thayyam, I know which caste that person belongs to. See, there is, as I said, it is a total art form. Performers are painters, sculptors, designers, choreographers, musicians and a man with some occult or mystical power. So it's a combination of all art form. I don't think there is any other ritual as encompassing all art form as they.
So people know Kathakali.
And so Theyyam is the original form. Most probably Kathakali might have used some of the rasams of Theyyam in their form. In Bhuta, it is almost a Bhuta and Theyyam are like two sides of one coin. There it is, the language is Tulu, and in Kerala it is the Tamil. It is also old Tamil. Malayalam, but Tamilized Malayalam. You know, a lot of 50% of expressions are Tamil. Even Kalaripayattu, that martial art of Kerala, all Vaithari, that verbal, narration of steps is are in Tamil. So in Theyyam, the head, decorations, Theyyam performance lasts for by about 10 minutes to 16 hours. Some performance will actually be 16 hours, but some will be only just 10 minutes. There are three stages of performance in most cases, both in Tulu Nadu and Kerala. See, one thing I noticed, the most primitive society all over world used three colors, black, white, and red. If they ever used a fourth color, they used a yellow or green as a fourth color, black, white, and red, and yellow or green. If they use a five color, it will be black, white, and red, yellow, and green. And subsequent development, development of society in the tribal belt from all over the world, even aboriginals in Australia or any other place, you can use this. By seeing the combination of color, we can identify which ritual was ancient, which ritual was earlier. There are Theyyam and Bhuta. In that, there are only three colors they use in painting, but not decorative item of leaf, that is different, but painting of mask or painting of body, of facial makeup and body decoration. Then if the subsequent colors are related to an object in every language, or to the extent I don't know all the languages, but I know some language, at least I studied on Indian language. Whenever I find some language, people from Rajasthan or Oriya or, Bihar, I ask them what is the color, name for this particular color. So after these five colors, if they use other color, it is related to an object like orange, turquoise blue, viridian, earth, cobalt blue, all these are related to an object. Same way, region language also, it will actually relate to an object. When it is come to subdued colors, that is an evolution of the progress of the color consciousness. The subdued color you'll never see. You see raw colors, and it's a natural color. Natural plants, greenery of Kerala may be the reason why they use so much of yellow and red in the ritual performances. But probably when I get another chance, I can give a presentation on ritual diagrams. Snake motifs and figures, diagram on the floor with the five powder colors. They use a three color, which is supposed to be the most primitive. Then if they use four colors, it's an evolution, it's another level. Then normally the Naga Kala, that is a snake motif, are drawn with the five colors. So there is rituals are associated with the colors, drawings, paintings, all these. And the Brahminical rituals are there, but mostly it is indigenous, original, native colors. You see, original mantras are not Sanskrit. Sanskritization took place only last 350 years. M.N. Srinivasa is the first person who coined the word Sanskritization. That happened only about 250, 300 years ago. Before that, they have magical sounds, magical words. That is their mantra. Unfortunately, this Brahminical Hinduism has intruded into the native culture and distorted to some extent.
Balanji, there's a question which has been addressed to you. So there's a one of the people from the audience has asked, I would like to know the proposition of the sculpture people see from different distances. How can we use the golden ratio when they get the best view? Any opinion on it?
It is originally designed in golden ratio. It depends upon which angle you are using. And there is a one sculpture, I gave the measurement, the trajectory of planet. I used the height and the maximum ellipse, the width of the ellipse as a golden ratio. So all subsequent nine ellipses are not golden ratio, which is not possible. But that way you have to take, at least it is designed with keeping in mind about the golden ratio.
Viewing distance of the person.
Yeah, from a far away also you can feel the same distance. The distance of the sculpture is not going to change. It is the illusion which spectators view that may change.
Thank you, Balanji. I think there's a couple of viewers who've asked for your contact details. I think they can go to your website.
Oh, yeah.
balanambia.com, and I think they can get your details from there. And I think there were quite a few things that we couldn't get to know about you. I think your enamel work, your mild steel work before, you know, all your research on the snake and the rituals around that. So I think there are lots of things to find out about you still. And I think, you know, I remember as a child going to NGMA and, you know, as a young adult, and seeing one of your sculptures. And I think also the sculpture that we've used on your poster, you know, it's such an iconic sculpture of yours. So thank you very much for this whole session. And you know, this whole idea of, you know, one of the things that my father often talks about is the idea of state of art. When people say state of art technology.
Yeah.
And it's such an interesting thing. You know, if you see a mobile of Calder's, or if you see a beautiful building design, which is historical, and you know, all the things that you said come about from there.
Oh, yeah.
So thank you for this very informative talk.
Last one comment to make, as a token of my affection and friendship and respect with Jadin, I present this complete record to JDCA.
Oh,
you can keep it as a record and your archival, but it is not for distribution to any other people.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Balanji.
God bless you.
And I just want to wrap up by saying that, you know, at the JD Center of Art, we strongly believe that arts is for all. And I hope that all of you share as much as you want to. You know, none of our programs are ticketed or have any commercial interest. We want people to really understand that arts is such an all-pervasive thing. And the next talk of ours is the 250th talk. So it's a very monumental thing. So Balanji, you're 249. So thank you for that. And the next one is on 13th of November on the second Saturday. So thank you and see you all there. Thank you, Balanji.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
Thank you, Balanji.
Thank you, IS.
Okay.